Tableau 2, Part 1, Elements of Counting. Historically, in the theory of chance, gambling and games of chance had a determinant effect, and in these settings, the primary goal was to be able to count numerous alternatives accurately and correctly. In such settings, elementary combinatorial arguments become of importance. Now, this kind of counting, while important, is not central to our purposes, but we do need the very basic elements. This is the kind of material that one should see ordinarily, sometime in high school, where one sees examples of ordered samples, and in particular, the binomial coefficient. This material then constitutes a review of the very basic elements of counting. For many listeners, this will be material that they are very familiar with, and if this is the case, you should skip ahead to the summary slide and take a brief note of the notations and the particular concepts involved before proceeding. For the others, proceed. In many settings involving chance, we start with finite populations. Let's say an example, five letters A, B, C, D, and E. Now, in settings like this, the semantics are rarely of importance. They add color to the picture sometimes, they add to the story, but in terms of evaluations of chance, they are typically not very relevant. So instead of our five abstract objects, we could have, for instance, five different pairs, or five different colors, or balls, or what have you. The particulars of the objects are not relevant for our purposes, though, as I did say, they do add color and sometimes a feeling for the subject. So let's go back to an abstract setting where we can look at the problem as a whole, divorced of its particulars. So let's go back to a collection of five objects. In this case, let's call them A, B, C, D, and E. Now, mathematical symbolism is important here because we want to be able to accurately describe the objects under discussion to each other and to strangers. So in accordance with this, when you talk about a population, a collection, a set, we think of a set of objects where the order is not particularly important or relevant. Of course, you could imagine laying it out on a table in some arbitrary order. But of course, then it becomes hard to get a feeling for the objects under consideration. And especially when writing it down on the written page, we tend to list them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, A, B, C, D, E in some order. But to reinforce the idea for us that the order is not important, we introduce some symbolism, some notation, some terminology. So, curly parentheses, curly brackets around the objects of interest suggest visually that this is a set. A set, a collection, a population where order is not important. Now, once we start with a set like this, a simple experiment would involve collecting elements from the set. This is called a sample. So, here, for example, is an ordered sample of three elements. Select A, and then C, and then C again. For example, a bosque pear, an orange pear, and a yellow pear. Three different elements. Now, you notice that in this selection, I have selected the element C twice. But the order, in fact, here makes a difference. And I make that explicit by putting the objects under a different kind of parentheses, round brackets. The round brackets are a visual indication for me that, in fact, the order of specification matters. Now, I have three different possible orderings of these two objects, A and C, chosen thrice. It could be A, C, C, as in the first line, or C, A, C, as in the second line, or C, C, A, as in the third line. And a little introspection will convince you that, in fact, there are no other orderings of the objects A and C, where C is chosen twice and A is chosen once. Now, what if we choose three objects from this collection, but with the caveat that an object cannot be repeated. Now, this is a province of sampling without replacement. So here's an example. Suppose we collect the objects A, C, and D in the order A first, C next, and then D. Now, a little thinking will convince you that there are six possible ways we could have selected these three objects, listed as I have shown you. Of course, one has to be very careful in making this such an ordering, because you don't want to miss any orderings, nor do you want to count an ordering twice. But in a setting like this, it's fairly transparent, and a little thought will tell you exactly how many possibilities. So far, so good. I'll now describe for you how we can select three objects from a given set of five objects with replacement and without replacement. How about we select three objects and we do not care about which order we select them? In other words, we select a subpopulation or a subset of the three. In this case, I've given you a subset of three elements, A, C, and D. And again, notice, visually, I'll put curly brackets around those three to indicate to us that these are three elements and their order of specification does not matter. I could have said D, C, A, encased in curly brackets, or C, A, D, or any other version, but as long as I enclose them in curly brackets, the order does not matter. It is a set. To summarize, sets are enclosed in curly brackets. Ordered samples where the order of specification matters are enclosed in round brackets. If you have an ordered sample, then the sample may be with replacement, where objects or elements are allowed to be repeated, or without replacement, where repetition is forbidden. Each object can arise at most once in that sequence. So the key elements that we have delineated so far are the ideas of a finite set or population and selection from that set to form samples. The samples may be ordered, they may be with replacement or without replacement, and if they're unordered, we call them subsets or subpopulations. Now that we've understood the three basic elements of sampling, we promptly generalize and think about a setting in abstract. So here we go. Suppose now we have a finite set. This is what we might call the universal set. Colloquially, we might say it's the population from which we are drawing elements. Now, we don't want to a priori put a restriction on how many elements we have in that population. Certainly not, because we could have 5, we could have 10, we could have 10 million. We search around for some way of describing how many elements we have. And of course, we resort to algebra, and we say we need to give the number of elements in the population a name. And what name could we give it? Inevitably, we call it N. Why N? Well, because it is inconceivable we call it anything else. Long tradition and custom, going back to our early school days, has conditioned us to call N an integer number for some integer variable. So, without further ado, we'll say the population has got N elements. And of course now, because N is not particularly specified, I'm running out of letters in the alphabet to describe the members of the population. So, we'll use subscripts 1, 2, 3, 4, through N to describe elements of this abstract population. And so, our population, our finite set, is A1 through A sub N, enclosed in curly brackets to remind ourselves that we are dealing with a population where the order does not matter. Now, it is from such a population that we are going to be talking about sampling. And of course, we're going to be talking about finite samples. So let's begin. If one has a sample, well, how many members should we have in the sample? Well, let's say K. K again is a generic number. It could be 3, 5, 7, 11, 100, depending on the problem at hand. It's an algebraic variable. Suppose one generates an ordered sample of size K. Well, what should the members of the population be in this ordered sample? Well, it could be the third element, followed by the seventh element, maybe the third element again, maybe the 103rd element, the 52nd element, and so forth. That gives you one particular ordered sample. To speak about it in abstract, let us identify the indices of the first element. Let's quite say we call it J1. The index of the second element, let's say, is a J2th element. The index of the third, J3, and so forth, the index of the last element, JK. The notation is admittedly getting a little cumbrous, but it is unavoidable. I'm going to have some way of describing which elements I've picked. So let us say the elements of the abstract sample are AJ1, AJ2, through AJK. If the sample is with replacement, then elements of the original population could be repeated in the sample at various locations. If the sampling is without replacement, then of course each element in that sample is unique and cannot be repeated. What about if one does not care about order? Let's say we are looking at the self-same collection of elements, AJ1 through AJK, now without repetition. And we say, I'm interested in this ensemble, this collection. We promptly encase them in curly brackets and say, this is a subset, or colloquially, the subpopulation in which we are interested. So here is the abstract setting. A finite population of n elements, a sample of size k. The sample may be ordered with or without replacement, in which case we encase it in round brackets. Or it could be unordered, where we don't care about order. It could be a subset, in which case we enclose it in curly brackets.